Hi, I'm Donna Jordan from Jordan Fabrics. Today I'm going to show you all about getting your quilt top loaded onto a quilting machine, picking out a backing, picking out a binding, and getting all these tops finished up. If you're like me and you enjoy making patchwork, you might get a lot of quilt tops built up because I sometimes want to finish the top and get on to the next quilt top. So I end up with a big stack like this, and we need to pick out a backing. So let's do this quilt first. You can see the colors we've got here, and I'm gonna get some bolts and see what might work well for the back. I like to get the whole top done before I even pick the backing. A lot of times I will have a backing color in mind, but once the whole quilt top is done, I will then get several different fabrics. I obviously have them on bolts. You will be doing this at a local fabric store or looking online for something that you think will make a nice backing. So here's some options here. This is a blue color that's in it. It's not a strong blue color in there, but I like the way it has some little stripes there. Sometimes I want a very light backing. This has all the colors. I think this might even be in the quilt top. That would look really good if you want a nice light backing. I do like to go with something that has a large scale, especially on a big quilt like this. That would make a pretty awesome backing. It's got the same colors and it's got those big ferns. So if you flip it over, that's going to have a really awesome look. This is much calmer. This is a smaller print, but again, very good color match. And then if you wanted to go with something real small, this is more colorful. I like the fact that it's got a little bit more color in it. I really think I'm gonna go with the big fern for this one. I cut the backing the length of the quilt plus an extra 6 inches, and I've seamed those two pieces together, and I use a big seam allowance here, and I am going to finger press this open. Some fabrics pull a little bit on that selvage edge, and if yours does, you would want to cut off the selvage before you did this. So the reason I use a big seam allowance here is because it's easier to keep that open and flat and not feel an extra lump right there when the quilt is done. So I'm just finger pressing this open. You can also iron it if you like, but I'm just pulling it open, pressing it nice and flat. The next step is to load the back onto the quilting machine. I have a Gammel machine and I'm very happy with it. There are other brands we hear from customers all over. Many people are happy with lots of different brands. There's a lot of good machines. So what I'm gonna do is I've got this canvas leader here that's attached to my top roll, and I've marked the middle of one side here with a pin, and this purple mark, that's the middle of the canvas. So I'm going to line those up, and then I'm going to pin my back all along the top here. There's other loading ways you can do this. Some people have some long strips they load with, but I pin along the top here. Once the top is all the way pinned on, I'm going to use the same procedure to pin the bottom edge of the back onto this far canvas. Once the bottom is all pinned on, now I'm just going to reel it up with most of the backing on that bottom roller there. And keep reeling it up till I've got just a couple inches of the top canvas showing, and then I'll tighten this one up, and there's a little lock here I flip so that neither roll will turn now. I've also got some straps with clamps to hold the back nice and smooth this way, so I will put all four of those on, and now we've got a nice flat stretched out backing. Next step is to get a piece of batting. There's kind of a rule. Every quilter has a little bit different parameters, but generally speaking, you want your backing and your batting to be about 6 inches bigger than your quilt top. So I need my batting 80 by 96. My batting is 96 that way, so I'm just going to cut a piece that's 80 inches. For my machine, I'm going to float the batting on here. So I'm just going to lay it right here. And it's not pinned on, it's not clamped on. It's just laying nice and flat here. And then I'm going to do one stitching line across the top, not to stitch the batting to the backing, just to make a nice straight line for me to line up the quilt on. My Gammel machine comes with a computerized program, and it has different stitching modes. We've got automatic that we use for quilting, and regulated that I use when I want to do a basting stitch. There's also a button you can click called channel lock. So the channel lock will make it so that my machine will go sideways, but not up and down at all. So it will only stitch in a perfectly straight line. And that's what I want right now. So all I have to do is press start. And when I move, because it's on automatic, it's going to just make one straight line all the way across the top of the quilt with a very large stitch. I folded the quilt top in half also so that I can mark the halfway point there. And then I'll use that pin to line up with my mark on the header so that I know I've got this centered, because this is kind of a big quilt and it can be a little bit hard to center a big one perfectly. So I'm going to line the top up even with my basting stitch up there. And since I've got that pin in the middle, I know I'm going to have about the same amount of excess on both sides. Next step is to baste everything together. So again, I'm using a very long stitch, and I'm just going right along the edges. And this will just tack everything down so that when I'm quilting the quilt, I won't end up possibly flipping something over. And this will keep everything nice and flat around the edges. I've got this quilt loaded on sideways. I call it laying down. And that is because I like to pin the selvage edges of the back onto my canvas. You can load the quilt the other way. You just have to make sure if your back is cut where there aren't selvages up there, that you cut it nice and straight so that you can pin it on nicely. Most patterns when you're quilting don't matter if you have it laying down or standing up. There's a few patterns that have a one-way design. For instance, if you're doing trees, I could not do trees here without them looking like they were sideways when the quilt was done. So we get that question sometimes. How do you know if you lay it on horizontally or vertically? Normally it doesn't matter, but I like those selvage edges pinned onto here. Thread color selection is next. And as always, there's many colors that will work. This is somewhat a matter of preference. There's not usually a right or wrong. There's just, what considerations do I have? Do I want it to blend in here and show up a little bit here? So that one is gonna not show at all in the background. This will show a little in the background and not much in the patchwork. And that is usually what I like. I don't like thread fighting with my patchwork. This is a good choice. It's going to be, well, it won't show up on the background at all, and it'll show up there. So if you want your thread to be prominent, that would be a good choice. This is just a bluer, a little bit darker blue. Again, going to blend in there, show a tiny bit there. I think we'll go with the light lavender. I try to avoid re-threading the machine, so I usually tie on the new thread color and then pull it all the way through. Sometimes it won't go through the needle and I'll have to re-thread the needle, but that time it went right through. Now that we have the machine threaded, we need to pick a quilting pattern. My machine came with lots of patterns already on the machine, And this one I think will look really good on this pattern because it has stars that are a little bit skewed there, and I like those curly cues. So the pattern comes, we're going to press reset, and that's the size the pattern was designed for. So I'm going to show you a little bit about this. I'm going to freeze the aspect ratio of it, and I'm going to measure how long my quilt is so we can figure out how many rows do we want to do. I suppose I could measure the quilt before I load it, but I always seem to wait till I get to this spot right here, and I'm just going to use my tape measure. Go all the way down. This one's on the floor a little bit. So we've got 74 and a half inches long. The first thing I'm going to do is change this to about 12 inches for the height of the row, because I think 9 is going to be too small. And then I'm going to start adding rows until this is about as long as my quilt. My quilt is 74 and a half, so now I can just change that to 74 and a half, and it's going to make each row 12.4 inches tall. My machine has an option for measuring the width, so I'm going to measure it using the machine. I'm just going to click right here, and I'm going to go all the way to the other side. And the computer will tell me if I've got it too high or too low, but I'm on the far edge. When I get that to about zero, I'm going to click OK. And then I can use this to calculate how many repeats we're going to have. We'll just click here, and it's going to do the math, and that's going to fill up the whole quilt. So I will press OK, and then we'll cancel that option, and we'll take it down to just one row here, because I can only quilt one row at a time, and that is what it's going to do for our first row. So when I press OK here, I've got it right at the start of the quilt. It's going to travel to its starting position, which will be at the very beginning of the first row here. So it should stop right on the edge here. Take one stitch. I will floss under to get the bobbin thread up and press start. And the machine will now quilt one entire row. When the machine is done with the whole first row, it will stop. I will take off these straps and clamps, and I will use my rollers here to advance it one row's worth of space, and then I will start on the second row, and I will keep doing that until the whole quilt is quilted. The first quilt is all quilted, and we'll take a look at it and all the other ones we finish a little bit later on, but right now we need to pick a thread color for this quilt. It's all shades of neutrals. This would be the most extreme thread we could use. It would make a dramatic statement, but I think it's a little too dark for me. This is a nice soft taupe color. That would show a little in the light, not much in the dark. A silvery gray would look nice. This is kind of an oatmeal color. That's going to blend in pretty well in the background. This is another color similar, a little bit warmer. And then we could even go with a darker gold. There are some darker gold grunges in here. I think this one will look the best. Even though the pattern of the quilt, the patchwork pattern, is called Starburst, I don't want to use stars in the quilting. I want to use something flowery because the prints that are in it are called Date Night. So let me make this a little bigger. So these are fairly simple flowers, and I think that will fill up all the space very nicely. I've already done all the measuring and programmed the quilting pattern. So all I have to do is press start. It'll come all the way to the beginning, and then it'll start quilting, kind of like a player piano. Thank you. Now we're starting to see the flowers and some of the stems. You can see them a lot better in this more solid background than you can on the printier parts of the quilt. For the next quilt, it's called Ocean Currents. That's what the quilt that's what the patchwork pattern is called. And I've got all these different colors, all of which would work. And with every quilt, there's a variety of choices that will look good. There's not a right or a wrong. I do like this blue. It's not going to show up much there. It's not going to show up much in the dark. And it's only going to show up a little bit there. Same thing with the purple. It's a little bit darker than our very lightest stuff. That would work. This would be the most extreme selection. And I don't think I'm going to like it in the very lightest areas. So that's a little dark for me. This one is going to blend in pretty well, but I have a feeling it's going to show up a little too much there. This would work. I just think the blues will probably be better. Here's a lighter blue. I think this blue will work the best, and that's what I'm going to go with. When I pick a quilting pattern for a quilt, I try to pick something that will look good on the patchwork. Calm Waters is one of my favorites because it's just back and forth and it does look like ripply water, and this looks really good on batiks. Sometimes I will pick a flowery pattern if the quilt has flowers, a circly pattern if it has circles, and sometimes I'll go the opposite way and use something very geometric on a patchwork pattern that is kind of curvy. Totally a matter of personal preference. I've got the Wave Runner quilt all loaded up, and we need to pick a thread color. There's quite a few threads that will work well on here. This one is not going to show in the light areas at all, but it's pretty prominent in that dark fabric. This will have the opposite effect. It's going to show up there. It's going to blend in a lot better in the dark areas. This one is kind of in the middle, so it doesn't show as much. Still shows, blends right in. This is kind of a dull green. That is probably going to blend in really well. That will show the least. I could go with gold. A lot of the prints have kind of a gold background. It's a little bit light. And then I have this variegated thread. Let's find the end of it. Now this has got more blue in it than my quilt does, but when you reel it off and actually look at it, even in the bluest sections, it's not got very much color showing. I really think that this one, even though it's pretty dull, I think that will blend in and show the least, and that's what I want on this quilt. For the quilting pattern, I want to use one that has a lot of quilting and is kind of abstract. This one is called African Maze, and it's just got kind of loose shapes, geometric shapes with a little bit of curve. And I think that will work perfect on this quilt. Here's the finished quilt, and I want to show you something about the thread color. On the edge here, it almost looks like the thread is gold. This is the color I used. Once you get up in here, you can see that it's green. I did use a gold color on the back side. I will often use slightly different colors on the top and the back. I can't use black and white because sometimes in a light area, if I had black on the bottom, you might be able to see it in the little holes where the needle goes through. So I don't use drastically different colors, but a little bit of color change is okay. This is a quilt with a lot of quilting on it. I like a lot of quilting. That's just my preference. A lot of people like it much more open, and it does get a little bit stiff when you put a lot of quilting on it. So people have mentioned to me that if they're going to sleep under it, they might want it quilted wider apart. For binding for this quilt, this would be a good choice color-wise. It's got all the colors that are in it. One of the downsides with this variegated fabric here is the stripes run this way, and I cut my binding this way, so I might have to be a little bit careful so that I don't get some dark and some light binding pieces. I think I'm actually going to go with this. This is the same as the backing, and this is the scrap that I had left over from the backing, and that will be big enough to cut all of my binding pieces. Because it's not the full width, I will have shorter pieces and more seams, but that won't bother me. The next quilt is Showering Stars, and this is pretty big, but we can get an idea of the quilting and the backing and then pick a binding for it. So there's great big stars, and that's why I wanted that large scale print on the back side. That just looks awesome. If you wanted to flip your whole quilt over some days, you'd have a really nice back on it. You can see the stars and swirls here, but they don't pop out too much. I think that was a good choice. It's slightly lighter than the background so that that quilting will show in these big plain areas. For binding, I thought I would use one of these more purpley ones because they match the top of the quilt very nicely. But when I look at the back side, I actually think this one will work a little bit better. This is in the patchwork, so we've got darker purples, we've got blue and green here, but this is in some of the patchwork, so I think that will make nice binding. For the Starburst quilt, I used this nice floral on the backside, and I want to show you some other fabrics I was considering for the backing on this. These are two fabrics that are in the same collection of fabrics I used in the patchwork. It's called Date Night. That would make a great back color-wise. You just have to be a little careful when you have squares going and stripes going both ways that you square it up before you put it on the backing. This would make a nice back also, but I think that flowery print just looks great. This is a quilt that I did the quilting pattern with much more space between all of those lines of quilting, and that makes it nice and soft. This is a bed size quilt, so I want it to wrap around me if I'm going to use this on my bed to sleep under. For the binding, I've already cut it, and this is exactly the same fabric that's used on this small border here. And so that will look very nice around the edge, and it also looks good with the backside. Ocean Currents, this is the one where we did the wavy quilting on. And it does look really nice. You can see it has a effect of water moving. Looks really nice. I like the darker blue showing in here. It blends in pretty nicely in those dark areas. And let's see about the back. Oh yeah, that really looks cool on the back side of it there. Now, I always seam my quilt backs. I always use 45 inch wide fabric. I don't use extra wide backing. Let's see if we can find the seam in it. I normally can't find it that easily by looking. I can't even find it that easily feeling it, but there is a seam here somewhere. The seam is right here, and I had to look a long time before I could find it, so I never worry about putting a seam in my backing. For the binding, I've got a couple of options. This is the darker lavender that's in the quilt. I think that would look good. I could also go with this one that's on the backing. I do often like to have a little bit of contrast so that binding shows, so I'm going to use this one. Thanks so much for watching our video today. We hope that gave you some good ideas on how to pick your backing, your binding, quilting pattern, thread colors. And at the end of every video, we do a giveaway. Today's giveaway is called Pop-Ups. This was a very easy quilt to make. We did this in a video, but today you can win it. All you have to do is click the link right below this video that says giveaway and put in your name and your email address, and you might be the lucky winner of this quilt. Now, if you like our videos and you want to support us, the best thing you can do is subscribe to our YouTube channel. That really helps us out. Happy quilting!